independence is that state where the people of a particular country suddenly have the right to decide for themselves what they want to do. In other words, it implies that we are no longer answerable to anyone as the nation of Zimbabwe. We are answerable to ourselves through the systems that we put in place. This country achieved independence through a protracted armed struggle.
Viva Zimbabwe! Viva Zimbabwe!
It became clear that the only way we were going to regain the control of our country was to fight. So we fought. The liberation effort got so hot to a point the white settler regime couldn't contain it anymore. So we forced them on a negotiating table. When that happened, there was a general declaration, is it, that we're now independent. We had to declare that we're now independent. We had to go through processes.
Gabriel Mugabe, do swear that I will be faithful and bear true allegiance to Zimbabwe and observe the laws of Zimbabwe. So help me God.
In April 1990, Zimbabwe held its first independence celebrations, marking an end to Rhodesian white supremacist minority rule. Born was a country that was to accommodate white Rhodesians and the indigenous black Zimbabweans into one unit beyond ethnicity, race, and political affiliation.
Despite our history, the colonial history, the human race or human beings are born equal before the Creator. Everyone is equal. It doesn't matter the shape of their nose, the color of their skin, the language they speak. We are all equal. There's no super race. So when we became independent, we became part of the entire human race on equal terms.
ZANU PF did not liberate only a certain group of people. It liberated everybody. Even whites were liberated, because to oppress somebody else is to oppress yourself. If you keep somebody down, you also remain down.
At exactly midnight, the Union Jack was brought down, symbolizing an end to a repressive era of inhuman colonial rule. The hoisting of the new Zimbabwean flag brought a new era of black majority self-rule. Joy and jubilation at independence. Joy for a new period that brought with it endless possibilities. A new world of milk and honey.
I feel very overjoyed, but overwhelmed, as I have said.
Well, I feel very good and feel very victorious.
Apart from the feeling of victory and jubilation, there were high hopes and expectations from the formerly marginalized black majority, who were hitherto victims of the wiles of imperialism.
And I'm expecting big changes, such as people in the squatters will be removed to big, to good houses.
We will give people food, houses, farms, money and everything they want.
Equal jobs, equal money and everything like that. There will be no racial discrimination between people.
Employment for my husband, better man for my husband, schools, clinics, peace.
Becoming independent meant that we had certain inalienable rights that we couldn't surrender to anyone. It was very important. The inalienable right, one of them, is the right to self-determination. These Zimbabwean people, in their totality, the citizens of this country, suddenly had the power to determine for themselves how they wanted their newly independent country to move forward in terms of beginning to address most of the aspirations and the expectations that people had. Obviously, cleaning up the mess that was created by the colonial system. That was extremely important.
In contrast to all the jubilation, joy, high hopes, and great expectations, there was a section of the population that felt defeated, with despair and a great sense of loss.
I am frightened because I feel we've lost the war. We've been fighting for it and all the things that everybody has fought for has gone. We've lost it. A little worried. I'm hopeful that this will sort of stop the war. If it stops the war, then I'd live under any conditions, quite honestly. The war has been dreadful.
The new government stepped into allay fears and preached a gospel of reconciliation, peace, and unity.
Well, the most important change in this country is that of our people recognizing themselves as one. What I mean is this: we have been divided into racial groups, white people, black people, so that all that was different, and be it in economic life, be it in ordinary social life, was based on this black and white. Once you change this and you make our people feel that they're one, then all those things that were divided along those lines could be solved.
What we need first and foremost is the consolidation of our independence. The forces that fought each other yesterday must now look at themselves as allies and work to consolidate peace and independence.
We extended our hand to the white people and practically convinced them that if they wanted to stay here, they would. This is why the former and late president declared a policy of national reconciliation, so that we would narrow the gap between ourselves and of course our former colonizers. In order to go forward, there was a clear realization that it was important to remove friction from amongst it. That's why it was done.
Despite the assurances from the new government, sadly, those who were once privileged could not come to terms with the new order. Some exhibited unrestrained anger.
Haven't you got any brains in your head to know what you've done? I think it stinks, and the British stink with it because you've just given a victory to bloody Russia, you idiot.
Even as the journey began, it remained to be seen how the country was to fare in such a relatively volatile and highly polarized environment.
The weight of the responsibility that is now on our shoulders is not a slight responsibility.
And this is how we start in 1980. The policies that were put in place were nothing but the sum total of a projection of what people wanted to happen. In other words, people wanted access to education, people wanted access to healthcare, people wanted access to the economy, people wanted freedoms, just freedoms in themselves, to be able to, freedoms to worship, freedoms to move to any area they wanted, as long as it was well within the laws as governed by the constitution of the country. So we achieved that. Remember, we went about working on the democratization of local government. We went about making sure that every community was linked by a road. We went about making sure that dams were constructed. We went about making sure that we maintained good relations with our neighbors. We went about building our army so that it was strong and would defend our country at any point in time. Went about creating all these critical institutions that would ensure that the independence of the state is preserved.
Besides the antagonistic white community in the newly independent Zimbabwe, there was a serious threat from neighboring apartheid South Africa that had a stranglehold on the Zimbabwean economy.
At any time, they can strangle us. I can give an example. When the turnaround of trends between us and South Africa was once at 13 days, and then they increased it to 18 days. They increased to 40 days. But after some discussions with them, they have now reduced down to 18 to 20 days. But under Smith, it was 13. So you can see that it is necessary for us to move away from that situation where, by the stroke of a pen, they can lengthen the 10 round of trends.
Apartheid South Africa was not at ease with the existence of a stable and independent Zimbabwe. The people of Zimbabwe stood as a beacon of hope and source of inspiration for black South Africans who were still under the oppressive imperialist system. Apart from the economic warfare, South Africa actually engaged in acts of terror and creation of terrorist groups. For instance, they sponsored rebels in Mozambique and were also behind insurgent activities like the Avondale incident. All these were foiled by the then Minister of State Security and the current President of the Republic of Zimbabwe, Comrade Emmerson Mnangagwa. Another menace rose from within, a misunderstanding between the two parties comprising the Patriotic Front.
First 10 years, we lost a lot of time because we had a lot of teething problems. You know, that's when they had all these skirmishes between Zanda and Zebra, all these Kukurawundi about the same time, and a lot of mistrust. It was very difficult. The question of dissidents as well, they also caused their own havoc. So it was the most difficult time of our history. But I must say that when unity accord came by, things changed completely. And we began to live like comrades, brothers and sisters.
In spite of all the challenges, internally and externally, Zimbabwe began a purgatory process to rid itself of all colonial vestiges. Even at a broader perspective, renowned African writer Ngugi wa Thiong'o, in his book Decolonizing the Mind, rightfully points out the ceaseless fight by Africans to liberate their economy, politics, and culture from foreign strongholds which were in existence even after independence.
We have our problems, it's true. But as Nkrumah says, freedom with chaos is better than servitude in tranquility. You see? When you are free, you are free. You may mess up what have you, you know it will be all right in future. But when you are oppressed, when you are a slave, you don't know even being a slave. You are always a slave.
Zimbabwe. Despite all the teething problems, the new Zimbabwean government forged ahead with the total emancipation of its masses.
We had problems with frequent droughts that were frustrating all the efforts that were doing them. I think in certain areas we had problems with obviously skilled labor. In some areas we had problems with the international trade protocols and so on. Early independence, we developed a very sophisticated engineering system with a steelworks complex based in Kwekwe, driven by Zisco, that had influence right across the country, right across the economy, and so the national railways' success was dependent on what was happening at Zisco. And so the construction industry, the road networks and so on, the steel industry was at the center of this, and it was very, very intricately organized and well-run, of course, until we start experiencing some problems. That's very important. We had a very strong textile industry in this country, and we're exporting finished products to Europe and many other countries of the world. Agriculture, not just in the raw form, processed goods were also moving into the markets. And we were a very critical player in the SADC region in terms of just exports and so on. Very important indeed. And I think much earlier on, government recognized the importance of the transport networks in order, since we are landlocked, to move goods from Zimbabwe to the other country. Remember, there was a big project that was that focused on building this Beira corridor, so that would move us our goods into the export markets and so on. It's a maze of all these things. If you recall very well, we didn't have a lot of universities, we didn't have a lot of polytechnics, so the emphasis on education made Zimbabwe a shining example. Up to this day, in fact, you would have to work very hard to defeat what Zimbabwe has done on the education front.
As Zimbabwe trudged on this revolutionary path to economic independence, the former colonial masters and their allies put in motion an intricate plan of destabilization. This was the beginning of an economic warfare that would later set a stage for regime change machinations.
Towards the end of the 80s, beginning of the 90s, we became a victim of the economic structural adjustment program. A country that had a very solid infrastructure in terms of industry and so on, suddenly embraced the Washington-driven reform initiatives, commonly known as ISIP, that forced us to open our borders. That forced us to roll back some of the functions of the state. Certain departments of government were closed, certain ministries were closed. In the meantime, we were opening ourselves to foreign textiles, the engineering and so on, because we're not actually at a stage where we're strong enough to cope with that. The whole economic structural adjustment program went very bad for us. Destroyed our engineering firms, destroyed our textiles, destroyed everything else that we had, including our transport system and so on. The government did not have the wherewithal to be able to support public infrastructure and so on. A lot of people were thrown out of employment. And naturally, if you throw people out of employment, it just means that you can't employ new people. So the whole question of a huge unemployed number of people starts with the ISAP program. It's giving us problems up to this day.
As the journey towards economic independence commenced in earnest, a bitter struggle was yet to ensue. The struggle for her natural resources, the struggle for her economy, the struggle for her survival.
This country did not come without a big fight. And the youth will be reminded that people must work hard to be rich is something that you should fight for and build yourself.
The Zimbabwean government remained resolute on consolidating the gains of independence.
When the land reform starts, it touches the nerve of the white person, and that creates problems for us. So the choice we had was to compromise and let them stay on the farms, but then what would have been the purpose of fighting, of liberating ourselves, of being independent, when we did not have our land, when our people were squeezed in very fragile ecological areas and so on.
After our independence, there was the question of economic emancipation. And our party, the ruling party, ZANU-PF, decided that the most important element to empower our people, the one element which was the strongest driving force for all those who participated in the liberation struggle, was the land question. The ZANU-PF government undertook the land reform program as an effort to democratize the land ownership in our country, to restore the land to its original owners, which had been taken away at gunpoint by the imperialist forces. Having lost the war on the battlefield, our detractors, our colonizers, could not accept the empowerment of our people through the land reform program. They had to resist.
And there's no way or place for me to go. This is my home. And this is where I intend to die.
In 1979, when we had our Lancaster conference, the British and Americans assured us that they will provide funding which we would use in the process of land reform on a basis of willing seller, willing buyer. But when Prime Minister Tony Blair came in, he abrogated that relationship. But we said, whether there's British money or there's no British money, we'll proceed to correct the imbalance.
Well, it's sad, isn't it, that we've got to resort to this kind of thing when there's no need for it. They're building up this land issue into a monstrous affair when there's no need for it, because they've got all the land they want.
They had failed to resist militarily, so they resorted to economic warfare.
The neo-colonial imperialists, who had been the major beneficiaries of this capitalist setup, reacted harshly. Zimbabwe was slapped with illegal sanctions, spelling doom to all post-independence developmental programs.
Sanctions account when my Western countries, Mugorea 2000, Pamsaka Pay, Pamsaka Pokuti, Takangeta Pachisungo, says ZANU-PF, Kuti Aiwa, Tavakuda in Furedu, Zokerekuman, Manabatele, Bravo.
So we are on the right course. Yes, there may be challenges that are caused by our detractors who appeal to our erstwhile enemies to punish us for doing the right thing. But we don't regret, and we're not going to reverse anything. to please the erstwhile colonizers.
The sanctions were imposed, as you may know, by the European Union, the United States of America, and the white Commonwealth countries to oppose the land reform program.
These illegal sanctions would remain in place until the present day. Their sole purpose was to make the Zimbabwean economy scream, so that the people of Zimbabwe would uprise against their government.
The sanctions which were imposed primarily by the European Union and the United States, basically to kill the economy, to make the economy scream so that the people of Zimbabwe can revolt against their government. That was the intention, that the people of Zimbabwe will find the economic situation so bad and blame it on the government and revolt against it so that they reverse the land reform program.
They are meant to cause people of Zimbabwe to rise against their own government. So it is a political strategy. Sanctions are a political strategy from the West.
The neo-colonial imperialists were relentless and used all means necessary to derail Zimbabwe's economic growth and effect regime change. One method used was the weaponization of human rights.
But the amazing thing is that the very same people who are now talking about human rights never raised human rights issues when human rights were being violated the left, right and center by the Smith regime and the allies.
All we know ourselves is that they were very much disturbed by our land reform program, and therefore the issue of human rights came after they've noted that it is our right to own our land.
Spanning two decades, the neo-colonial imperialists would continue their assault on the Zimbabwean economy in an attempt to destroy the ruling party, ZANU-PF.
We push on, and you remember after that, we had to look at new relationships. China was emerging and we started looking east because the West wouldn't be willing, or rather wasn't willing, to talk to us. Therefore, we couldn't just stay behind and allow ourselves to collapse to zero. The problems deepened, as you know, more and more, because the idea of the Western world then was simply to remove the ruling party from office.
They used Zimbabweans in the opposition political parties.
The United States Congress must continue to do what it has done very well in the past. I think everyone must know that there's a reward for good behavior. There's a reward for constitutionalism. There's a reward for international engagement.
They've been talking about sanctions and not imposing any. We have called for EU long time ago to impose targeted sanctions to have any effect on the behavior of this government.
The sanctions were put in place to support me. They were put in place to support Mr. Morgan Tsvangirai, our Prime Minister.
Opposition in Zimbabwe is about anti-development. You know, they don't want to see us develop, to the extent that they want people to suffer just for them to get into power. But our people have indicated, they've shown their resilience to such misconceived policies.
Sadly, they also used elements in ZANU-PF to destroy the party from within.
Kuchaitwa extraordinary congress. Saka isusu before that sambotaurwa nachipanga
Before that Congress, muna November muno turned out constitution it changed accordingly. Eh? Dunia zvitanga inini.
Charama kuda. Charama. Charama George. George, George, George.
Consequently, the revolutionary ethos began to be negated due to criminals that had sneaked in and infiltrated the revolution, taking advantage of the aging leader of the ruling party, Robert Gabriel Mugabe.
For any avoidance of doubt, the ZANU-PF Youth League is fully behind the Secretary for Women Affairs, Dr. Grace Mugabe, in calling for the urgent removal of Comrade Mnangagwa from the position of Vice President, both in the party and the government.
You know, this carried on and on and on and on, until obviously we get to this point where, because of a combination of forces, some external, some internal, a few problems begin to emerge even within the ruling party itself. And so it's part of the journey, is it?
This caused great danger to the independence revolutionary process, as well as posing a huge catastrophe of civil unrest and national security at large.
But eventually, a very radical situation develops towards end of 2017.
The Zimbabwe Defense Forces intervened to protect the presidency and preserve national security as enshrined in the constitution through a revolutionary process which was coined as Operation Restore Legacy.
Section 212 of the Constitution of Zimbabwe mandates the Zimbabwe Defense Forces to protect Zimbabwe, its people, its national security and interest, and its territorial integrity, and to uphold this constitution. It is our strong and deeply considered position that if drastic action is not taken immediately, our beloved country, Zimbabwe, is definitely headed to becoming a neo colony again.
This military intervention triggered a plethora of other democratic processes. In Parliament, constitutional proceedings ensued to impeach the then president.
Allowing his wife to threaten to kill Vice President Mnangagwa and other government officials. Seven, causing disaffection amongst the defense forces by allowing his wife to make reckless and false allegations against the country's defense forces.
On the streets, the masses marched peacefully for the aging president and the cabal of criminals surrounding him to step down.
Today, he must go today, not tomorrow. Want him to go today.
The longer he wants to play hard game, it's the more it's going to be painful to him. The people have decided. End of day, there may be this or that constitutional provision. The truth is that the people of this country have made a decision that Mugabe can no longer be their president, and he needs to respect that.
At a party level, the ruling party, ZANU-PF, through the Central Committee, recalled the then president, Comrade Mugabe. Comrade E.D. Mnangagwa, who had been unfairly dismissed, was reinstated. In addition, he was voted the party's first secretary.
The people have spoken. You yourself said, if the people say I must step down, you shall comply. This is the time to comply. Because the voice of the people is the voice of God.
This paved way to the new dispensation and the process of consolidating the revolutionary struggle was rejuvenated under the able leadership of His Excellency Emmerson Dambudzo Mnangagwa.
Today, we are witnessing the beginning of a new and unfolding democracy. No one is more important than the other. We are all Zimbabweans. We want to grow our economy. We want peace in our country. We want jobs in our country.
When we're getting towards this period, I'm talking about the second, the creation of the second republic, there's already a mountain of expectations, a mountain of, shall I say, demands from the public, the citizens. They want changes to be made in how the country is run. Let's get a new focus, let's get a new vision, let's get something that aspires and inspires the people and so on. Yes, the situation emerges with Comrade Idi Mnangagwa as the new head of state.
It is with a deep sense of gratitude and humility that I stand here today to address you, fellow Zimbabweans, upon my inauguration as President of the Republic of Zimbabwe, having been mandated to form the next government following the outcome of the just ended national plebiscite.
What happens after that? There's a complete new discussion, a complete new vision, and so on. He recognizes that the country is obviously polarized. And what does he do? He says, let bygones be bygones. Let's start anew. I say this because the new dispensation it's extremely important to understand what it is doing and what it represents. Because essentially it represents progress. It represents expanding the frontiers of democracy. It represents expanding the tolerance zones. You see what I mean? You are really saying, yesterday we would fight, but today let's negotiate. Point number one. Point number two, I will be a listening president. I want to listen to as many people as is possible, get all sorts of ideas from people and make sense of them and respond to the needs of the people. Thirdly, he is saying, can we actually force politics into the second role? You're not abandoning politics, but he's saying the most important thing is not politicking. The most important thing is to reconstruct the country. And that reconstruction is economic driven.
Economics, trade cooperation would be priority to the new order in Zimbabwe rather than politics as a priority. This is what we are going to do.
The president took foundational steps towards the socio-economic transformation of Zimbabwe. For instance, the process of re-engagement, reforms, as well as infrastructural development.
In Zimbabwe, in order to catch up with the region, you know, I'm sure you're aware that Zimbabwe has lagged behind in many areas as a result of isolation for the past 16 or 18 years of our history. Now, we are saying to the world, Zimbabwe is now open for business.
The president took a diplomatic offensive approach to re-engage countries whose relations with Zimbabwe were sour. This was necessary as no country can survive in isolation, as Zimbabwe is existing in a global village.
At the time Zimbabwe left the Commonwealth, it was on the issue of the land reform program, which was unfolding in Zimbabwe at the time, and we differed on that one. But now, as far as we are concerned, the land reform program is behind us. All that is there now is the interrogation of it and say, are there people of multiple farms or on issues of boundaries and so on? But the issue is out. And I believe that most of the Commonwealth countries accept that that program is done. So there is no impediment anymore. Even those who were against us in the past, Zimbabwe is now open. To me, there shouldn't be an enemy I cannot talk to. I believe that the people of Zimbabwe have no case against the American people, nor do the people of America have any case against the people of Zimbabwe. This is a question of international relations. If President Trump came here today, when I'm still around, I'll be able to talk to him. I'll be able to make requests from him and say, oh, Mr. President, Zimbabwe is open for business. I know Americans like to play golf. Come and build golf courses at Victoria Falls. Bring American Airlines, Victoria Falls, build hotels. And they'll give you incentives, 5-year incentives for you to do all those things.
Back home, Zimbabwe embarked on political and socio-economic reforms. Subsequently, President Emmerson Mnangagwa outlined Vision 2030, which projected an upper-middle income economy by year 2030.
We have committed ourselves to Vision 2030 to transform and develop our country into an upper-middle income economy.
The most critical and most important of what the president is offering Zimbabwe, he said, listen, I know that the country is starting, particularly the new dispensation, is starting from a very low position, but this is what I offer you. By 2030, all of us, if we put our efforts together, we need to have developed this country so that it attains an upper middle income status.
It is a vision. You know what a vision is? A vision is the objective that you have set yourself to achieve. So the president gave us a vision of saying 2030, we need to be experiencing a middle income sort of society. And we are working towards that. Let's take the Minister of Health for instance. We have managed to source quite a lot of equipment from other countries. We've managed to bring in quite a lot of drugs. We've managed to build clinics and to refurbish the old ones. And we have done this with the assistance from other countries. So all that is going towards the fulfillment of that objective or that vision the president has set himself to do.
In a short space of time, Vision 2030 has begun to shape up thus far, as well as bearing fruits.
We've seen work that's still going on the dualization of roads.
One night, Avaka Bridger, Tagazram Kwakwau, Kuta dualized. Apana. Maria Vakumwe, ukavona mugwagwa unobva kuHarare uchinda Masvingo. Une zvikamu zviri kuvakwa. Ukavona mugwagwa unoenda bva muHarare uchinda kuKwaMutare. Une zvikamu zviri kuvakwa. Ukavona mugwagwa unoenda kuKanyemba. Kwakusina kana mugwagwa taenda kune helicopter. Kwava nemugwagwa uri kuvakwa. Kupiko. Province mune imwe ine chiri kuvakwa chiriko.
We've seen a lot of work going on there, repair and improvement of schools, giving universities leeway to be able to think on their feet and make a contribution to society. We've seen the ZUPCO on the transport side, passenger transport. We've seen ZUPCO that was almost dead and out coming back to life. We've seen the importation of agricultural equipment. We've seen the strengthening of the presidential input scheme, the command agriculture, and so on. We've seen quite a number of things. We've seen a paced up dam construction
program.
President Mnangagwa, we are happy that he is making sure that the trajectory that this country is taking will become a success. We are cognizant of the fact that economic reform is not an event, but it's a process. If you look at political histories of nations, you will realize that it's not easy for nations to become where they are supposed to be. But we are happy with the laid down foundations, that the foundations with President Mnangagwa's administration has placed accommodates young people. We are talking about the issue of the recent amendment of the constitution where 10 youth are supposed to participate in parliament. That's involvement, that's empowerment. We are talking about the issue, the promise that he undertook, the issue of making sure that youth have got access to land. He promised that after land audit, youth are going to be beneficiaries of land, because most of the youth have got the energy. We want this land. And the new dispensation led by President Emmerson Mnangagwa is actually concerned and making sure that we get this land. Youth are allocated this land.
Ndakukurudzira Minister wedu weclans na Minister we youth my parents shiri na cast covetry kuti va paridze kuva nechidiki vapinde ku agriculture tigovatsigira sehurumende kuvapa zvokushandisa.
So we have got a government, we have got leaders who fought in the liberation struggle. They are in the new dispensation. They are still fighting for the people's cause. And we as the youth, we are happy and we have got every reason to celebrate during this independence.
The financial arrangements have been put in place. Your agri-bank is there, your youth bank is there, your women's bank is there. The central bank is right at the back. They are looking at everything that's going on and looking for opportunities to ensure that these programs are supported. And there's a lot of work that's being done to support centers of higher learning, whether it's the research efforts and the enhancing the conditions of service for the lecturers and maybe making sure that when these kids come out of university, they're very critical programs that they can go into. And obviously,
kare tichafunda isu takati tikafunda unoita teacher oita clerk oita nurse iko zvino vana vedava nezvavako iko zvino zve ICT. We need to empower our children to be innovative, to be scientists, to create products, to make sure that their fertile ideas are translated into products to save our people. Taka introduce my innovation hubs muma universities edu iko zvino izvi kubva pa 18 months dzataita izvo zvizvi. We have now over 90 patents
or inventions zvaitwa nevana vedu nyika muno.
To attend that, we are very brilliant girls and boys in this country.
We've seen efforts at ending the isolation through engagement and re-engagement. It is moving ahead.
We have created a platform which we call Pollard, where every single political party can find expression. We have never experienced such unison and cohesion and happiness.
We have seen a president who is not afraid of the opposition at all. He's invited them after, obviously, the general election 2018. You have one party that continues to say that it can be part of that process, but all other people who were part of that process were invited to come together, form a dialogue platform where they and the president talk together to map out which way Zimbabwe goes, because bringing all these people who believe they have a stake in the future of Zimbabwe and talk to them, even if they don't have the legitimate right to be part of the governing process, was in itself a masterstroke.
Poland is a platform where we seek to be united in Zimbabwe.
Because if things are well for the government, it means those things are well for the country. There's never been a platform of this nature where diverse political parties come to one table and still debate on issues which we do not agree on, but to seek to find middle way, a compromise, seek through debate where the best argument takes the day.
And this effort continues. That one party is saying they can't do that. It's not important. End of day, what's important is that the people of Zimbabwe, represented by all those different shades of opinion, they are represented at that table where the critical economic, social, political challenges are being discussed so that we can narrow our differences and maybe very broadly participate in making sure that our economy is back on rail.
I think the collective voice should be heard more than isolated voices in the jungle.
As he had envisioned, President Emmerson Mnangagwa knew that a nation at war with itself cannot develop. Hence, he embarked on an intensive nation-building exercise, uniting the people of Zimbabwe as one, beyond ethnic and political differences.
We must be united to assure our people of decent livelihoods through inclusive development and growth, which leaves no one behind. We should never entertain politics which mobilize around narrow anti-nation sentiments. Zimbabwe is a unitary state, and the politics operating below that constitutional dictate should be rejected.
The president has emphasized the issue of making sure that we invest in building peace in this country. Let's invest in making sure that the people of Zimbabwe, regardless of our different political visions, but let's have all people in Zimbabwe come together, unite for the purpose of preserving, you know, the values of this country, our history, our heritage, and our identity as a people. Let's face that world as one nation. So nationhood is very critical. And I would say that the president has been on a massive nation-building process.
We are as good and as strong as we are united, today, tomorrow, and forever. All generations, all citizens, and all leaders of this nation must continue to renew, affirm, and reaffirm our unity as a people. We should never tire to work for national unity, to think, act, and to live true to its dictates. Zimbabwe is and must remain a home to all who belong to, reside and believe in it. Today, more than ever before, we need national unity.
Well, how has the president done that? He's had discussions with the church, he's had discussions with business, he's had discussions with your social movements and so on. And he's been talking to those people, he's been talking to the youth, he's been talking to the academia, he's been talking to anyone who is prepared to meet him. And on very open terms.
The executive has its role cut out. The judiciary, they have their role cut out. The legislature, they have their role cut out. The private sector have their role. But there must always be dialogue between all these institutions, the private sector and the public sector. Us, the executive and the legislature, we must dialogue. Us and the judiciary, we must dialogue. And that is what I think brings harmony in the country. So that the challenges which we face, we should share those challenges and the solutions as we move together.
Again, remember, he does that because he's already told you, I'm a listening president. I want to listen to everybody. It can't be better than that.
We are willing to receive new ideas to improve what is already there.
There's nothing that is cast in stone. You're allowed to come. I'm a listening president. You can come to me and air your views, but obviously I will have your views checked by the experts.
Therefore, when you look at the new dispensation, there's a combination of very, very positive things that are critical when you are expanding the boundaries of political tolerance, when you're expanding the democratic or democracy or democratic frontiers and so on, when you are actually saying let's create an inclusive society where everyone has a stake in the economy. But you see, the most important thing that this president is talking about is you are not going to reap where you have not sown.
We should move away from handouts. You must be productive, production. Nokuti ndio inauguration speech yamwari ye production ilachezia. That has not changed.
His words, mucharga jezia, work for everything. He's trying to bring back the work ethic.
We need to inculcate honest hard work among our people. When that is done, anybody who sees that somebody does not value hard work and values criminality, I mean, those people will be exposed. It's a process. I believe that if all of us continue to say, let us be honest, let us be honest, hard-working population, then we cross the River Jordan.
So we see there a man with a vision. So, end of day, how does this then tie up to our independence? Remember, when we become independent, we are taking responsibility for self-determination. We're taking responsibility for creating policies that work. We're taking responsibility for making sure we create a government that responds to the needs of the people. But we also should make sure that the public understands that government cannot achieve all that without the support of the public. If the public wants government to achieve most of these things, we need order socially, we need stability, and we need people who are prepared to sacrifice, because you can't succeed without any form of sacrifice. We're in that stage where everyone just thinks things will happen here miraculously. I'm sorry, that won't happen. We need to commit to hard work. Independence does not mean just getting things for free. Independence means you take responsibility for your own actions, you take responsibility for making the contribution to the success of your own country, you take responsibility to protect your nation, you take responsibility to respect the order of the day. And once all of us get to that level where all this comes automatically, I think Zimbabwe is set for very exciting times ahead.
So to us, a generation which we call, we are the liberated, we're born 5 years after the independence. We are a generation which is enjoying the fruits of the liberators who brought the independence of this country. So it is now our mandate to ensure that what they fought for is not in vain. What they fought for, we protect it.
So we're now coming in as a new generation, born after independence, with access to the economy, unfettered access to the economy, unfettered access to education, unfettered access to science and technology, and we are the free generation. This is the only country that we have. And it's no fun of Senza, Tita Utinika Edubir. Akuna Mona, Chavos, Tibasa, Zimbabwe, in a first world country.
We need to make sure that our legacy, we define our legacy. What is our legacy? Our legacy is to ensure that we make Vision 2030 a reality. So the youth of 1970s had a legacy. Their legacy was to make sure that they displace our colonialism. And our generation now, we have a mandate to make sure that we take this country to a better place in terms of development, working together with our elders. We believe in generational blending, where our elders guide us on what to do.
As we move towards another level of prosperity, the 40th independence anniversary continues to remind Zimbabweans of all the revolutionary gains and how to consolidate them.
The development is a process, it's not going to be an event. It requires the change of behaviors, change of attitudes and so on, accepting new things, embracing technology so that we can use it to maximally improve our conditions. Then that is very critical.
Together we can, for independence is a process and not an event. Zimbabwe, 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 Zimbabwe,